So, hello and welcome to my talk. Before I start, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation and for the possibility to present our latest results. So in my talk, I would like to start actually with a surprising observation. And this observation goes the following way. Consider the structure shown over here, which is basically a very thin multilayer made out of magnetic and non-magnetic materials. It turns out then that if you illuminate this so-called spintronic terahertz emitter on one side with a femtosecond optical pump pulse, that on the other side, you get out a terahertz pulse. And not only that, what is even more surprising is that the amplitude of that spintronic terahertz emitter is quite large and even larger than standard terahertz emitters that you find in the community. Even better, when you take the Fourier transformation of these time traces, you find that this spintronic terahertz emission covers a very broad frequency range. Basically, it covers the entire terahertz window from 1 to 40 terahertz without any gaps. And in my talk today, the central motivation is, why does that work? How does it work? And once we understood it, how can we make it even better? But let's go step by step. So first, what is terahertz radiation and why is it interesting? So terahertz radiation is an electromagnetic wave with a wavelength of 0.3 millimeters and the duration of one oscillation of 1 picosecond. If you look at the entire electromagnetic spectrum, you find that the terahertz window is located in the center here between the low frequency side where you have the RF radiation and the high frequency side that is covered by lasers where you have the visible light and so on. And one photon of terahertz radiation has an energy of 4 millielectron volts. So it is quite a low energy. So you might wonder, why do we actually want to combine terahertz with spintronics? Well, first I have to tell you what spintronic actually is. So you might all know that in conventional electronics, the charge of the electron is used to encode information. Now, spintronics goes one step further and it wants to use the spin degree of the electron to encode additional information. And if you want to do information processing using spintronics, you basically need three ingredients. First of all, you need some kind of a source of spins, a so-called spin battery. Second, you need to transport the spins from A to B through space. And the last goal is that you would like to turn around your spins, you would like to manipulate them. And when you look at conventional electronics, you find that it actually aims already at terahertz rates. So there are first transistors that have a cutoff frequency of around 1 terahertz. And if you look at the new communication standard, which will be 6G in the future, those also aim at the terahertz range. So in order to be competitive, spintronics also has to work at terahertz rates. And in this talk, I would like to concentrate on the first two functionalities, which is the spin battery and the spin transport at terahertz frequencies. So let's go to the first step, to the battery. So how can we do that? How can we now build an ultra-fast spin battery? And for this, I would like you to imagine the following very easy experiment. Imagine you have a piece of iron, it's magnetized in one direction and it has a certain temperature. Now, when you heat up that piece of iron, what you typically find is that the magnetization decreases. This means that some spins have dissipated their angular momentum to other degrees of freedom, such as the lattice. So the question is, how can we do that in an ultra-fast manner? And the answer to that is pretty easy. You just take a femtosecond heating pulse, a femtosecond optical laser pulse, you illuminate your thin iron film in that case, and you find that you get an ultra-fast quenching of the magnetic order. That is known since a long time. And since you get here a change in the magnetization on a picosecond timescale, you will have a radiation, a so-called magnetic dipole radiation, that will be in the terahertz range. Now let's take a look at actual measurement data from a thin iron film. And this is what you find. So this is now the magnetic dipole radiation from an iron film as a function of time. Actually, it's the recorded terahertz signal. But how can we be sure that this is actually encoding the dynamics of the magnetization? Well, the answer to that is that we can go forward and extract the actual dynamics m of t from this recorded terahertz signal. And in a second step, we will then record this recovered m of t with the magnetization dynamics that we measured with the magneto-optical Kerr effect. So let's do that. So when we calculate back from the terahertz signal that we recorded to the magnetization dynamics, then we find this ultra-fast behavior. So a drop on a 200 femtosecond timescale and then a slow recovery. And when we compare this to the MOG data, which is known to be a quite good probe for the magnetization dynamics, which is shown here in black, we find a reasonably good agreement. So we can conclude that this is actually magnetic dipole radiation. And we see clearly here that the magnet wants to lose its spins on a 200 femtosecond timescale. So how can we understand that? Well, we can understand this if we look at a typical band structure that you find in a 3D ferromagnet, which looks like this. So you have the two density of states for the up and the down spins that are shifted in energy with respect to one another. So if you count the two spin sub lattices, you find that one has more than the other, and therefore you get a finite magnetization. Now what happens when you heat up the iron quickly with a femtosecond laser pulse is that you actually get a splitting of these two chemical potentials of the mu's for the up channel and the down channel. And this splitting just results from the fact that these two spin channels have a different band structure. And when you do the math correctly, you find that it's given by this integral over here that just accounts for the occupation number of the two channels. And this splitting of the spin chemical potential now is the driving force that gives rise to the spin flips inside the ferromagnet that then leads to the demagnetization. So in our language, this is the spin voltage that drives the magnetization quenching. Okay, so basically we have seen that the magnet wants to lose its spins within 200 femtoseconds, and it's the spin voltage that drives it. And in a sense, we have already built now a terahertz battery. So let me turn now to the second goal. So how do we now transport the spins through space quickly? Well, the idea is pretty simple. So we just would like to attach another layer over here into which we would like to inject the spin current. But the question is, how can we measure it actually? Well, we can measure it by not attaching any material, but by attaching a very special material. And in this case, it's platinum, which is a heavy metal with strong spin orbit coupling. And as such, it has a spin dependent deflection by an effect called the inverse spin Hall effect. So what basically happens is that if a spin is incoming into the platinum, into that direction, it's getting deflected into the transverse direction. And thereby you obtain a charge current transverse to the initial spin current. A little side remark here, all spins for artistic reasons throughout my talk, they should actually point into the plane or out of the plane, but I always draw them in the plane. Okay, but the important point is here, if you inject the spin current into platinum, you get a transverse charge current. And this is again ultra fast, it has picosecond dynamics. And as such, it will again radiate a terahertz pulse. This time, it's not magnetic dipole, but it's electric dipole radiation. And let's compare these two experiments, the single iron film compared to this bilayer made out of iron and platinum. And that's the data that I showed you before. This was the magnetic dipole radiation from the single iron film. Now, let's have a look at the bilayer. Very same experiment, heating with femtosecond laser pulse. And what you basically find here in blue is the very same dynamics for the electric dipole radiation compared to the magnetic dipole radiation. That's a surprise. What else is a surprise is the orders of magnitude that we have here, difference. So it's about 100 times stronger, the electric dipole radiation, than the magnetic dipole one. So why is it so strong? You might wonder, do we really transport spins by the spin voltage into the platinum? So we have to do some sanity checks here. And that's what we did. So we now take the bilayer and we look at the terahertz signal for one orientation of the magnetization in the plane. When we rotate the magnetization, we find that the terahertz signal perfectly inverts. So the signal is magnetic. And we find that the terahertz electric field is always perpendicular to the magnetization. A second check that we can do is that we can grow the stack in reverse order. And when we do that, we find again that the terahertz polarity switches, which is as expected, since the direction of the spin current also changed in that case. So we can conclude that this radiation from the bilayer is an electric dipole that is perpendicular to the magnetization. And this is perfectly consistent with the scenario of the inverse spin Hall effect. However, as a final check, we would like to exchange now the paramagnetic material here. And that's what we did. So this is, again, the emission from iron platinum. As a check, we attached a very light metal now, copper in this case, and we see here in orange that the terahertz emission is almost completely gone. However, when we attach another heavy metal, namely tungsten, we find this orange curve, we get again a strong emission, yet with reversed polarity. Why that? So what is going on in platinum versus tungsten? Well, actually, these two materials are well known in the field of spintronics, and they are known to have a strong spin Hall effect, so a strong spin deflection, yet with opposite sign. So what does this mean? Again, in the cartoon picture, whereas in platinum, the spin up in this case gets deflected downwards. In tungsten, the very same spin gets deflected upwards. Therefore, the charge current reverses its sign, and you get an inverse a polarity flip in the terahertz emission. Okay, so with this, we are now safe to say that from the single iron layer, we get a magnetic dipole radiation, whereas in the bilayer, you get the inverse spin Hall effect scenario and you get an electric dipole radiation. So we can already understand the different amplitudes here. So this is basically since magnetic dipole radiation is typically much less efficient than electric dipole radiation. So this explains this factor of 100. However, there's the second observation of the very similar dynamics. This somehow suggests that this spin current that you inject here, and this that gets then translated into a charge current, that this is somehow proportional to the change in the magnetization of the single layer. But how can we understand that? Why is that? So let's go back to that band structure picture. So remember, in a single iron layer, when we heat it, we get that splitting of the spin chemical potential, the spin voltage. And when you now do a similar analysis in the bilayer system, you actually find that you open up an additional channel for spin dissipation, which is the transmission through the interface. And then inside the non-magnetic layer, the spins can undergo spin flip events. And you basically have to do the math just once more. You have to now count the interface transmission events in the bilayer. And what you find is for the spin current that goes over here is this very similar or basically the same integral as for the local spin flip events in the single layer. And thus, these two processes are driven by the very same thing, by the generalized or non-equilibrium spin voltage. And if you're interested in more details, you can find it in our very recent preprint on the archive. So what this tells us is that this spin voltage basically jumps immediately, and that all you have to do is that you have to excite or heat the electrons as quickly as possible. And then the relaxation dynamics are given within the very same model, because for both, this is the same. So all that you have to do is you have to compute this convolution up here, where you have to basically know the electron spin coupling time, this gamma ES, and you have to know the electron excess energy, which is basically given by your pump pulse, time evolution, and the electron phonon coupling. Okay, but let's take this quite simple looking model and apply it to our data. And that's what we did. So we have this expression over here, and we know the electron spin relaxation time from theory or from literature, I should say, which is 100 femtosecond. And we know the electron excess energy and its dynamics. When we compute this, we find this thick grayish line that nicely agrees with the magnetization dynamics for the single iron layer. We can do the same game, we can play the same game for the bilayers and for platinum. We find this nice agreement with the spin current, and even for tungsten, we can do it again and again, very nice agreement between theory and experiment. And we even confirmed this behavior, the similar dynamics for M dot and JS for different ferromagnets, not only for iron, also for Cofeb, for Cofer, and for permalloy. And let me just highlight this once more. In order for the spintronic emitter to work, it's only important that you heat the electrons as quickly as possible. Okay, and this brings me to my first summary. So we understood up to here that in these spintronic terahertz emitters, you basically heat up the iron, and this leads to a spin voltage, to a splitting of the spin chemical potentials. Secondly, you get a transport of spins out of the iron in the center into the tungsten and the platinum on both sides. And there, the inverse spin Hall effect converts the spin current into a charge current. And this then gives rise to this efficient electric dipole radiation. And the driving force behind all of this is the excess electron energy, which gives rise to the splitting of the spin chemical potentials. However, one question remains. Why are these terahertz pulses that you get here so broadband? Or let me rephrase that question a bit. How fast is the spin to charge conversion actually? Is it immediate? So in the second part, I would like to show you how to measure spin to charge conversion at terahertz rates. So what we want to do is we want to understand how this spin Hall effect that I depicted here once again, how fast it works. And just as a reminder, so the spin Hall effect is this spin dependent scattering where you have some charge current here with spin up and spin down electrons, and they get deflected in opposite directions. So you get no effective charge flow in the transverse direction, but an effective spin flow, a spin current. However, it turns out that spin currents are notoriously difficult to measure, also for optics. And this is why the idea here was to turn away from the paramagnet to a ferromagnet. And in a ferromagnet, the situation is a bit different. So you have more spins of one orientation than the other. This is why you have a net magnetization. And if these spins now are driven, or these electrons are driven through the ferromagnet, they again undergo the spin-dependent scattering. But this time you find that, okay, for simplicity, I only drew one spin species, but you have more of one than the other. They all go into one direction. So you will not only have a spin current in the transverse direction, but also a charge current. And this is then called the anomalous Hall effect and not anymore the spin Hall effect. And this is a conversion from a charge current to a charge current. But how can we measure this effect now at terahertz speeds? And for this purpose, we performed the following experiment. So we did a terahertz transmission measurement, which you might also call a terahertz Faraday effect measurement. So what we did is basically we had an incident, a linearly polarized terahertz field with an incoming electric field and an out-of-plane magnetized ferromagnet. So what this electric field does is that it drives a charge current in the plane and a certain amount of the field is transmitted. Most importantly, however, due to the anomalous Hall effect, there will be a new component transverse to the driving electric field, this delta JC here, which is an additional charge current and which will also radiate into the far field. So behind the sample, your initially linearly polarized terahertz electric field will have become elliptically polarized. And this we can measure in our lab with an analyzer and with a 10 femtosecond resolution, basically. And please note that we are not the first ones to perform such an experiment. There are many more nice works that I cite here. However, I think we are the first study of relevant materials covering the entire range from 1 to 40 terahertz. So let's take a look at the actual data. Now, this is the transmitted terahertz electric field that you get for one orientation of the magnetization. Now you flip the magnetization and you find this black curve. And you see down here that you get a small effect. And if you subtract these two curves, you actually find this anomalous Hall effect induced transient that is on the order of 1% of the driving field. But can we be sure that we probe magnetism here? And for this purpose, we compare now hysteresis loops once measured at optical frequencies at 600 nanometers versus terahertz hysteresis loops. And we find this quite perfect agreement. So we confirm thereby that the effect is of magnetic origin. And this now allows us to actually extract the terahertz spin to charge conversion efficiency versus frequency. And what do I mean by this? Well, we compare the ratio of the driving electric field to the induced current in the plane. And we call this gamma, the spin Hall angle or the anomalous Hall angle. And when we plot this versus frequency from 0 to 40, we find that it's basically frequency independent and it has a value of about 2%. And what more we find is that it basically has, there's no delay between the driving current and the anomalous Hall current. So that shows that the anomalous Hall effect is operative up to highest terahertz frequencies, 40 terahertz. And with this, I come back to my summary slide. So now we can understand why it is that broadband, because actually spin-to-charge conversion is operative up to 40 terahertz. Okay, now we have understood it. So are there applications of the spintronic terahertz emitter? Yes, there are. So first of all, if you upscale these devices, and this is pretty easily possible, you can get very high terahertz electric fields. Secondly, you find that it's very insensitive to the pump wavelength because at the end, it's just a fast heating of the electrons. You can also grow these emitters on flexible substrates, which is pretty nice for some applications. A very recent study found that you can use these thin film emitters to perform near field imaging, and they allow for a deep sub wavelength resolution. You can even enhance the performance by some antenna design. And in a very recent collaboration, we could show that you can use them as a very fast photodiode to characterize X-ray pulses that you get from large scale facilities. And lastly, these emitters also became commercially available very recently. And if you're interested, please visit terraspintech.com. Okay, with this, I would like to come to the conclusions and to the outlook. So I hope that I could show you that spintronic effects remain operative at terahertz rates. We found that the terahertz spin transport is driven by the same force as ultrafast demagnetization, which is by a generalized spin voltage. And in the future, we would like to use this knowledge that we have from ultrafast demagnetization to enhance the spin currents even further. And eventually, we would like to use the spin currents to exert torque on remote spins. So with this, I would like to thank all the people that contributed to the work, which is basically the terahertz physics group at the Free University and the Fritz Haber Institute. I would like to thank the groups of Pete Brouwer, Peter Oppenheer, and Yuri Mogrusov for the theory support, and the groups of Matthias Kloy, Dimitri Turchinovich, Markus Münzenberg, and Georg Woltersdorf for sample supply. And with this, I would also like to thank you for your attention.